Right, so today I'll be focusing on pericyclic reactions, and many of you have requested this particular topic. So let's begin with the introduction, right? And I'll try and keep it short because you can find the theory everywhere, but it's the application on how to solve the numericals or how to solve the organic reactions that have been asked. You should know that basically. So I'll be focusing more on that and less on the theory part. Theory you can find in any book, right? And you won't struggle with it. But just for the generalization, I'll just talk about a little bit about the pericyclic reactions. So we have basically what are the main characteristics of pericyclic reaction, okay? So the if you have a base or a nucleophile or an electrophile or an acid, it does not affect the rate of the reaction because pericyclic reactions have a concerted mechanism, okay? What I mean by concerted mechanism is that it takes place only in one step, right? Similarly, radical initiators, radical terminators, they do not, interfere with the reaction. The polarity of the solvent does not affect the rate of the reaction, right? So it is, and the product is unaffected by the polarity. It is unaffected by a base or an acid or a radical terminator, radical initiator, and all of these pericyclic reactions. The one common thing is that they go through a cyclic transition state, right? So all of them, they generally go through a cyclic transition state. Okay, right. So now let's talk about and one more thing is that these reactions are stereospecific. They are stereospecific. See, you should know the difference between stereospecific and stereoselective. When I say stereoselective means domination of one particular enantiomer or one particular diastereomer over the other is known as a stereoselective reaction, right? If you have a 60% enantiomer as a product and 40% of the other enantiomer, then you can say that the reaction is stereoselective. But when I say stereospecific, that means that out of the two possible enantiomers, I specifically, 100% of my yield is of one particular enantiomer only, right? So I do not get even 1% of the other enantiomer, then I can say that the reaction is stereospecific. That is, I am only able to obtain only one enantiomer. So this is the main difference between stereospecific and stereoselective. Similarly, chemospecific and chemoselective means, again, the same thing. Chemoselective means, the major yield will be of a particular product. But if I say chemospecific, that means only that particular product will be formed, right? There will be no major minor product. There will be only one product. Okay. So now let's begin with where is my duster? Yeah. Okay. Now let's begin with the pericyclic reactions. So the main concept you have to understand over here is the reactions are not tough. Only you have to determining the stereoselectivity of the reaction is important. So firstly, there are three major reactions, okay? One is electrocyclic. I mean, there are more than three, but there are three major reactions, and I am categorizing it into electrocyclic. And electrocyclic reactions are basically ring opening or ring closing reactions, right? So for example, I have 1,3-butadiene, okay? And in presence of heat or light, this is converted to cyclobutene. And similarly, the reverse process is also possible. So it's a reversible reaction. I mean both from cyclobutene we can have a ring opening reaction and we can get a 1,3-butadiene, or from 1,3-butadiene we can get cyclobutene. So any one of them is possible. So it's kind of a reversible reaction. Now the main thing about these reactions is stereochemistry, okay, of these reactions. And one common feature about these reactions is, if for example here we have two pi bonds, right? We have two pi bonds over here, and over here we have one pi bond. But over here we have, say, n sigma bonds, and over here we have n plus 1 sigma bonds, right? Because what happens is basically this double bond migrates over here, attacks over to this double bond migrates like this, and we get cyclobutene, right? And when from cyclobutene we are getting back to 1,3-butadiene, this bond breaks like this, and we get 1,3-butadiene, right? So basically, if we lose one pi bond, we generate one sigma bond, and if we lose one sigma bond, we generate one pi bond. So this is a common thing with electrocyclic reactions. So if we lose one pi bond, we get one sigma bond and extra sigma bond, and if we lose one sigma bond, we get one extra pi bond, right? This is common to electrocyclic reactions. Okay, now let's talk about the next category, that is cycloaddition reaction. The most common example from cycloaddition reaction is Diels-Alder, right? And so now let's talk about cycloaddition. So the most common example is Diels-Alder, right? And so we have this, and our product is basically, right? And what happens is this bond migrates like this, this bond shifts, and then this one attacks like this, and what we get is this as a product, right? Now what is the common feature of these reactions? One more reaction is this formation of cyclobutane. We have two ethene molecules, and so this attacks like this, this attacks like this, and we get a cyclobutane. So what is the common feature you can see? We lost two pi bonds and we gained two sigma bonds. So we lost two pi bonds, there were three pi bonds, right? 1, 2, 3. Now there is only one pi bond. And how many sigma bonds do we have? So 1, 2, 3, 4. And over here we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So there's 6 sigma bonds. And over here we have 4 sigma bonds. So we have lost two pi bonds and 2 sigma bonds we have gained. Similarly, over here we had 2 pi bonds. And over here we have 0 pi bonds. And we had 2 sigma bonds, now we have 4 sigma bonds. So there is a loss of 2 pi and gain of 2 sigma. So this is the common feature to all pericyclic, so all cycloaddition reactions. So for electrocyclic it was 1 pi and 1 sigma, and for cycloaddition reactions it's 2 pi, 2 sigma. Okay, loss of 2 pi, 2 pi electrons, and gain of 2 sigma electrons, 2 sigma bonds. Oh, sorry, not electrons, bonds. So we lost 2 pi bonds, we gained 2 sigma bonds, and in electrocyclic we lost 1 pi bond and gained 1 sigma bond, or vice versa, right? Okay. And the third category is sigmatropic. Okay, and mainly questions come from either, actually they come from all the three reactions. That's why it's common. Generally sigmatropic I think is accounts for more than 30-40%, and cycloaddition and electrocyclic account for 30% each, right? But main questions generally come from sigmatropic. Okay, and what is the common feature of sigmatropic? So in sigmatropic what happens is, for example, we have this kind of molecule, right? This kind of molecule we have. Now what happens is this bond migrates like this, this bond migrates over here, and this deuterium shifts over here. So what is our product is, we have now so we have a hydrogen, deuterium, and we have two deuteriums over here. So what basically happened was this: the double bond, the pi bond migration took place, and one of the deuteriums shifted its position. So overall, if you see the net reaction, there's no loss in pi bond, there's no loss in sigma bond. The number of pi bonds and the number, there were two pi bonds, there are two pi bonds over here. Similarly, the number of sigma bonds are also constant in this case. So there is no change in sigma and pi bonds. So these kind of reactions are sigmatropic, right? So this was very important, because sometimes in the exam what is asked is, identify the type of reaction, and they will give you four categories, match the following, right? They will give you electrocyclic, cycloaddition, right? And sigmatropic, then they can give you group transfer reactions. That is also a very small category in pericyclic reactions. They are known as group transfer. And then the other category is Aldrin reactions, right? So in the subsequent lectures, I will be talking about these kind of reactions as well. In today's lecture, I will be focusing more on the electrocyclic reactions, right? So this is just a general introduction that I had to give to you guys, right? Okay. So now let's talk about electrocyclic reactions. And you will see how simple it is to solve the questions once I finish with my lecture, right? And just let me see whether it's filming correctly or not. Right, so I think it's going fine. Okay, so let's take cyclobutene, right? Now, how is a sigma bond formed? You should know that, right? So what basically happens is, I'll just rub it off. I'll just draw the orbitals, okay? So we have the overlap of these orbitals. Let's say this is plus, plus, minus, minus. So the this is a sigma bond. This is the overlap, right? And when we draw the product, what is the product? 1,3-butadiene. The product is like this. Now you should know the difference between the sigma bond and the pi bond. In sigma bond, what is happening is the sigma bond is formed with the frontal overlap, right? By what I mean by frontal overlap is if I take this I take this duster only. So this is frontal overlap, right? This, or I can show with my fist. This is frontal overlap, right? And what is sideways overlap? The pi bonds are formed by sideways overlap. So the sigma bond is formed by frontal overlap, whereas the pi bonds are formed by sideways overlap, right? So the pi bonds are formed like this, sideways overlap, or if I show it with my hands, it's formed like this. This is the sideways overlap, and frontal overlap is like this. Sigma bonds are formed by frontal overlap, and the pi bonds are formed by sideways overlap, right? Overlap of the orbitals. So this is one key thing that you have to understand. Now from over here, if you see the orientation of these orbitals, it is frontal overlap, right? But now it is forming pi bonds. So from if I draw the structure for this, the orbital structure, it is something like this. Okay, it could be plus minus. Here also we can have plus minus. Or you could have minus plus or minus plus. I'll come on to that later, in which case we have what kind of orbital. But basically what I want to tell you is that from this kind of position, now the orbitals are in the vertical position. So over here for forming the sigma bond, they were in the horizontal position, but now they are in the vertical position, right? So what will happen to the stereochemistry? That's what we have to find out. Okay. Now, just note down a very important thing, and I'll tell you what where we use what. Okay. Note down these two terms. One is con rotatory. Okay, and disrotatory. So we'll be using these terms a lot. So you should know the meaning of these two terms. One is con rotatory, and the other is disrotatory. So con rotatory means same direction. Con rotatory means same direction, okay, and disrotatory means opposite direction. Okay, so if I talk about 1,3-butadiene, and I told you these are our orbitals, right? I'll draw both it. So either we can have plus minus, okay, both plus minus, or we can have both minus plus, right, plus minus, or we can have minus plus, okay, or we can have plus minus and minus plus. See, either this plus minus and these both are, see, the plus slope is on the above side, right? Over here also the plus slope is on the above side. And the minus slope is on the below side, right? Or we can have the, so basically what I mean by that is that both the lobes are in the same direction. So the minus slope is below and the plus slope is above. Or we can have the minus slope lobe above and the plus slope below. Okay, so or I'll just draw it so that you can understand it in a better fashion. I'll just draw all the possible orientations of these orbitals. So don't get overwhelmed. It's a very easy topic, okay? Just follow my lecture. Just understand it. It's very easy, right? I just don't know, how much you have understood it. So I'm just teaching it from the very basic. So we can have minus plus, and we have minus plus and plus minus. So these are the four possible orientations of the orbitals. Okay. Now, if we consider this kind of orbital, so over here, now to form a sigma bond, these are the examples of 1,3 butadiene, right? Different orientations of the orbitals of 1,3 butadiene. Now, if you have to form cyclobutene, so these have to rotate to form a sigma bond. Okay, these have to rotate to form a sigma bond. Okay, so to form a sigma bond, see, the plus minus can't overlap. Only the plus plus can overlap or the minus minus can overlap. Okay, so in which direction can we rotate this particular orbitals so that we have either the plus plus interacting with each other or the minus minus interacting with each other. So if I rotate this in this particular direction, okay, if I rotate this in this particular direction, so the plus one will come over here, right? And if I rotate this in this particular direction, so both the plus will interact with each other. So excuse me, I'm rotating it this way, that is anti-clockwise, and I'm rotating it this one as clockwise. So this one I'm rotating clockwise and this one I'm rotating anti-clockwise. Okay, I'm rotating this one anti-clockwise so that both the plus come in the same plane and then they can interact. Or I can rotate them in which way? I can rotate this way, or I can rotate this clockwise so the minus one comes up, and I can rotate this counterclockwise so that this minus comes over here and these minus minus can interact. So if you see over here, I am rotating clockwise, this one anti-clockwise, or this one anti-clockwise and this one clockwise. So basically I am rotating them in the opposite direction, right? So I am rotating them in the opposite direction. And what I told you, opposite direction means disrotatory. So I have to rotate them in the opposite direction to get a disrotatory. I have to rotate them in the opposite direction to form a sigma bond. So the sigma bond, if the orbitals are in this orientation, will always be disrotatory. Okay. Similarly, if I come over here, now it will be a similar case for minus plus and minus plus also. So these two kinds, you have to rotate in the opposite direction to form a sigma bond. So these two examples over here are the examples of disrotatory. These two examples, this one and this one, are examples of disrotatory motion. So if the orbitals are in this orientation, then disrotatory motion will take place for the formation of sigma bond. But if I come to this case, now if I have to take this plus over here, I rotate this clockwise. Now similarly, now this plus is over here, and for the sigma bond formation, this plus also has to come over here. Now how can I rotate this plus so that it comes over here? Again clockwise, because I want this plus to come like this, so I have to rotate it clockwise. So now I am rotating both in the same direction for the sigma bond formation. Since in the same direction I am rotating, so this is contrarotatory motion. This is contrarotatory, right? This is contrarotatory. So these two cases are of contrarotatory. So the orbital orientation will be in contrarotatory motion will be such. Okay, so you have to remember this. In disrotatory motion, the plus lobes will be in the same side and the minus lobes will be in the same side. Whereas for contrarotatory motion, the plus and the minus will be in the opposite side. So plus lobe over here, but the minus lobe over here, right? So they are on the opposite sides. So you have to just remember this for now. Okay, all right. So next we will talk about contrarotatory, disrotatory we have done. Soon we will come on to the stereochemistry, right? Don't worry about it. Now you have to write one important thing. And before that, let me check whether the vehicle is filming.
I'll just improve the focus.
Right. So, if we have a 4-pi system, okay, and I heat it, 4-pi system and I heat it, we get contrarotatory motion, okay. If I have a 6-pi system, I heat it, I get a disrotatory motion. If I have a 4-pi system, I pass light, I get contrarotatory motion, and disrotatory. And if I have a 6-pi system and I pass photochemical light, I get contrarotatory motion. So this table is very important. On this basis, you can solve any question that comes from electrocyclic reactions. So 4-pi, heat, con. So if you remember any one of them, you can find out the others. See, if you remember 4-pi heat, con rotatory, alright? So if at 4-pi heat you're having con rotatory, then at 6-pi heat you'll have disrotatory, right? And if you know at 4-pi heat you're having con rotatory, then at 4-pi light you'll have disrotatory. So if you remember even one of them, you can predict the other ones, right? So 4-pi heat gives con, 4-pi light gives disrotatory. And 6-pi heat at the same time will give disrotatory, right? So if you remember this, 4-pi heat gives con, then you can say that 4-pi light will give disrotatory. And if 4-pi heat is giving con, then 6-pi heat will give disrotatory, right? So this is a table. Now what is this basically? It's 4-n-pi system. I've just taken example for the simplification. It is actually 4-n-pi system. So 4-pi system, 8-pi system, 12-pi system will all follow this. Okay, the 4-pi system, and all the 4n plus 2 pi systems, 4n plus 2. So I've taken the example 6-pi because if I put n equal to 1, then it becomes 6-pi. So all the systems with 4n 2 pi electrons, for example 6-pi, right, 10-pi, 14-pi, and so on so forth, will follow what 6-pi follows, right? So this is the simplest example. That's why I told you this. So you multiply this by 2, 4, 8 pi, 12 pi, 16 pi. Similarly, you will get the same kind of rotation in those systems. And for all 4n 2 pi systems, 4n plus 2 pi systems, like 6 pi, 10 pi, 14 pi, you will get similar to 6 pi system, right? Okay. So just remember this table. It is very, very important for you to understand. So it's actually very simple because, like I told you, if you just remember one of them, you can predict the other ones, right? So now let's look at some examples. And I'm sorry if the video quality is not good. That's why I'm trying to write it as big as possible so that you can see clearly what I'm writing, because I don't know, my autofocus of my phone is not working properly. So I'm having a lot of troubles. And I'm sorry for the quality, if there's some problem with the quality, right? So now let's do some practice questions. Not practice questions, now let's look at the stereochemistry on how to identify the stereochemistry, right? So before that, I'll just look up at the video. Right. So, if I have a 4-pi system, this is a 4-pi system, right? Because this is what, 1,3-butadiene. Now 1,3-butadiene is a 4-pi system because they have 4-pi electrons in 1,3-butadiene. Okay, now we have been given this kind of a product. Okay, and let's say we heat this 4-pi system, and on the other hand we'll pass photochemical light to this 4-pi system. Okay. So we are heating it and we are passing photochemical light. So what I told you was 4-pi system, heat, will give what motion? Contrarotatory. Right? 4 pi heat will give contrarotatory and 4 pi light will give disrotatory. This is what I told you, right? So I'll draw the product over here as well. I'm taking the same reactant in both the cases. Now what I told you for disrotatory, what is the orientation of orbitals to form a sigma bond? Both should be above the lobe. I mean both signs should be on the same side. So plus plus, minus minus. And for conrotatory, what did I tell you? Minus plus and plus minus. That is opposite. Right? You can take any one of them. Minus plus or plus minus, it does not matter. So disrotatory motion. Disrotatory means we are rotating these orbitals in the opposite direction. We are rotating them in the opposite direction. So if I am rotating this counterclockwise, I have to rotate this clockwise. So let's rotate it. So let's rotate this clockwise. So this minus sign, minus one comes over here. This minus orbital comes over here like this. Similarly, this minus also comes over here like this. Right? So if I draw the product, so the minus lobes are interacting with each other, right? These are our plus lobes, okay? Now what will happen to this CH3? I am rotating this one counterclockwise, so this CH3 is going to come down. See, it is on the left side, so now it is going to come down. So if I am rotating it counterclockwise, I am rotating it like this, so this CH3 is going to come down. So this CH3 is going to come down and this hydrogen is going to come up. We are going to get a cyclobutane basically, right? So I have just drawn the double bond. And so the CH3 comes down. Now if over here also, if I rotate this clockwise, this CH3 is on the right side. So if I rotate it clockwise like this, this CH3 will again come down the plane. So now both the CH3s are down the plane, okay? So the stereochemistry of the product is trans. So these two methyls are cis. These two methyls are cis to each other. Okay, you can see it from the methyls or from the hydrogen. So both the methyls are in the same plane, in the same direction. So that is why the product is cis. So 4 pi system, we heat and it's rotatory and we get a cis product. Now let's predict for this one, for conrotatory. Now in conrotatory, what did I tell you? They'll move in the same direction. So if I'm moving this clockwise, I like clockwise direction. And if I'm moving this clockwise, you can move it both counterclockwise, you will get the same product, it does not matter, okay? So I am rotating both of them clockwise. Now if I rotate both of them clockwise, this minus comes to this side, right? If I rotate this minus, moves this side, and similarly this minus, if I am rotating this clockwise, this plus will go this side and this minus will come this side, right? If I am rotating like this, this minus will come over here, and similarly if I am rotating like this, this minus will come over here. So I'll just draw the product. This is our sigma bond formation, cyclobutene. Now what will happen to the methyls? So I am rotating both of them clockwise. So this methyl, if I am rotating it clockwise, this methyl is going to go above. So we have this methyl above, this hydrogen below. Okay? And if I am rotating this one also clockwise, then this methyl is on the right, so it will come down. Now if you see, these two methyls are trans to each other. So the same reactant, just the difference in the heat and light. Just the difference of heat and light, we are getting the opposite stereochemistry, right? So this is pericyclic reaction, electrocyclics, and this is how you can predict the stereochemistry of the reaction, right?